You know, last week we started the very special parasha, the Yitro, and this is when we receive the 10 words, the 10 commandments, the principles or 10 statements that the scripture gives us. What I call it, the constitution that our creator gives to all humanity. One of the things that I have been trying to bring to you is that the Ten Commandments are not for only Israel, but for the whole world. And one of the greatest mistakes that has been progressively announced and said is that the Ten Commandments are only for Israel and the Torah is only for Israel. And this is a big mistake. Was Israel, as a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, they had a purpose, and the purpose was in their calling to bring those words to the rest of humanity. Now, and in this portion, the next one, in Parasha Mishpatim, this is the Parasha of the Mishpatim comes from the word Shafat, judge, you know, and we can call it justice, we can call it rights, the rights of the people. But more important than that, I want to make an emphasis here. The Ten Commandments are the basic, is everything that really we need. Everything else is pure commentary and is an application. The Ten Commandments are the principles of the Torah. And the rest are applications about the Ten Commandments. In other words, if you have the Ten Commandments, you can derive justice for the rest of everything that you're trying to apply. What is interesting is that our Creator brought us the Torah for the people, for us to be able to live together, to have a relationship with each other, you know? Because as I told you last week, the Ten Commandments or the Ten Principles were divided in three portions. The first portion is the relationship with the Creator. The second portion is the relationship with ourselves. And the third portion is the relationship with our neighbors. You know, they call it Ben Adam Le Javero, between the man and the neighbor. This is the third part. Mitzvot, Chukim, Mishpatim. These three portions made the whole Torah. And then we are going to see later on how we apply these principles in situations that are unique. But one thing that I would like also to express today that is very important. Today, we have that sense, and this has been an application from the Lex Romana and for other types of codices, is the idea that once the rule is given, you know, then comes another judge or comes another court and amplify the rule. And then everybody, little by little, we are accumulating and we are creating a rule behind another rule, behind another rule, and we're creating a big, big stand of rules. And there is the idea of the precedent takes over the decision of the judge is going to be. I do not believe that that was the intention of the Torah, of their creator for us. The intention of the creator and always has been is that we need to do justice. We do, that the Torah was given to us not to be vindictive, but to help people, to aid people, to reform. This is a way to help and to have a true living. You know, when you try to create a precedent and little by little, without realizing, you eliminate the reason of the scriptures why was given to us. For example, in the scripture there is one that say, "You shall not commit murder." Most of the people have translated, "You shall not kill," and then they have gone through extremes to try to justify one way or the other, depending where do you belong. But the principle, it is always that your life has been given by the Creator. And every human being represents our Creator. And life is sacred. And we do not have the right to take that life unless that creation is becoming destructive and is destroying. And they need to be stopped, not to destroy more. This is the basic principle. But it's not vindictive. It's to repair the situation. And it's to help the people and to bring justice. Many times we confuse ideas because we have been going so far and so, we have become so humane, we say ourselves. And it's very interesting that today in the modern world, humanism is replacing the wisdom of the Creator. You know, human people are smarter now than the Creator. Why? Because the religion of today, the God of today, is ourselves. We are humans that we have evolved and we have put ourselves in a pedestal. And this is not something new. That was before giving the Torah. Do you remember the Babel Tower? You know, they made the Ziggurat and they started saying, let's build something to be like gods. Man has always tried to replace the Creator. And this is the reason that they created, they invented what I call a religions. And one of the evils that we have today, sounds terrible to say this, are the religions. Most of the religions are going to tell you we are right and the rest of the world is wrong. Most of the religions, they are going to tell you that if you do not follow my ways, I need to kill you or destroy you. Most of the religions, they have love only for themselves. How different it is what the Torah teaches and what our Messiah Yeshua came to do. You know, this is very important that you understand, because when Yeshua, our Messiah, started his work among us, the first thing that he started was with the so-called the Sermon on the Mountain. And what he started doing is very interesting. He exemplified what were the basics of the believer, the relationship with the Creator that was in ourselves, a relationship with him and a relationship with our neighbors. You shall love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with your all everything. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The Ten Commandments. The relationship with God, the relationship with myself, and the relationship with the Creator is there. And then he said, I have not come. Very interesting. I have not come to destroy. I have not come to abolish. I have not come to change the Torah. Totally the contrary. I have come in order that the Torah will be fulfilled, done, practiced, taken care of, to follow the Torah. And that is one of the symbols of the true Messiah. Bring us back to Torah. Another thing that I need to tell you is that when he started his ministry among the people of Israel, he specifically spoke to Israel, not to anybody else, only to Israel. Why? Because Israel had the responsibility to bring the Torah to the rest of the world. Israel needed to be Or Legoyim, what it means, light to the world. This is how he started. And whatever he has done as the Messiah, he has done according to Torah. Then you have a religion who teaches you that Yeshua not only destroyed the Torah, get away with the Torah, but now you don't need to follow the Torah. And you ask yourself, that is Yeshua who said that? A rabbi who knew the revelation of God? He could say something like that? And then you are going to see that it's not possible. That is another religion. Then our rabbis, they created the Noahic laws, the seven laws that the Goyim needed to keep it, the minimum. You know, we keep 613, you only need to keep seven. We are better, you know? And then even they had the chuspah to teach some of them. That you are a goy, you are a goyim. You don't need to keep the Shabbat. You don't need to keep any of the Torah. No, only the seven laws of Noah. And I asked the rabbis, show me where are these seven laws that supposedly the Creator gave it to Noah. He gave some instructions what not to do. And they has added all another things. This is the problem that we have when what? We follow men and we do not follow the Creator. Yirmiyahu Hanavi was not wrong when he said, cursed be the man who follows men, but blessed be the man who follows the Creator. This is the basics of what I am trying to bring today with this Mishpatim. Because Mishpatim, that means the rules, the rights, the judgments, the principle of the Torah, and these Mishpatim are the application of the Torah. What do we need to do any time that we ask ourselves, what do we need to do? Let's go back to the Ten Commandments and see what the Ten Commandments are, and we need to see how we respond. In the scripture, they give you moments, they give you applications of the principles of the Torah. For example, here start with the treatment of the Hebrew slave. Later on, it's going to talk about the goy, the girl, the foreigner, a slave. But why we start with the Hebrew slave? Because we just had left Egypt. And when we left Egypt, what are we were? We were slaves. We're mistreated. And the principle that the Creator is going to show to them is we were slaves in Egypt. Now we need to learn how to treat ourselves and our own people and the other people. We need to learn instead to be vindictive, to be magnanimous, to be merciful, to help them. And justice, pursue justice, like in the Devarim say, Tzedek, Tzedek, Tirdof. And this is the pursuit of our Creator for us as His people, to pursue justice in any area of our life. This is the reason why Israel is in the middle. Israel is looking for justice in the world, for everybody to have the right to be a human being. And that won't be disqualifications, discriminations of putting down anybody. And it's obvious that the world is not following those principles. Why? Because look at the mess that we are up to. Now, let me go back to something. Where are the places that we have more problems today? and you're going to see it's based on religion and political issues. There are two things that go hand by hand, and it is amazing. When somebody, one time, we were talking about, somebody said to me, all you Jewish people deserve to be judged because you kill Jesus Christ. How many times I have been told that? First of all, if you are a historian, you're going to see that the Israel didn't kill Yeshua, were the Romans who killed Yeshua. You know, we are going to do, but yes, there was a collusion of two groups, the religious group with the political group, a state and religion. They got to, and they make a collusion. For the religious group, Yeshua was a problem. Why? Because he was trying to bring back to Torah. And why was a problem? Because these people that had put themselves in a position of being the leaders of Israel, they had changed the Torah. There was no any longer the Torah. What was more important was the oral Torah, the Sheva Al Peh. And what the Sheva Al Peh did, it started changing the meaning of the Torah. They start giving the understanding of men instead to let our Creator speak for himself. And little by little, the people of Israel were getting away from the real Torah. And today, we are doing the same thing. You know, you ask any of these major religions, the basic foundation. One of the things I hear over and over here, especially in Canada and United States, we are a Judeo-Christian ethics. Judeo-Christian ethics? Give me a break. Where those things that is, you really say that you follow Judeo-Christian ethics? The morality of United States and Canada are down to the sink. I am not here to judge. I'm here to tell you, and this is basically true. You know, when you today, you think life is not important and it's not sacred, when you think morality is not any longer valuable, and you can do whatever you want to do, that is not Judeo-Christian ethics. You see, yes, the Torah teaches you to respect the rights of your neighbor, and to not to go over your neighbor's right, and to be responsible for your actions. That's what it is. All of us, we need to be responsible for what we do. You made it. You pay for it. You know, we are responsible. We cannot blame somebody else. What is today ethics? Blaming the other. Whatever happened, he made me do it. I was pushed for that, you know? And there's nothing new. We had the same idea from the beginning with Adam and Eve. Do you remember when the Creator said to Adam, you can eat from everything, you can do it, and this is, you have the garden. But from this tree, you shall not eat. What comes? Eve, and Eve has an interchange with the serpent. And the serpent convinced Eve that was going to be wonderful for her to eat that fruit. You know? And why? Very interesting. You will be like God. If that question comes to Adam, Adam say to the serpent, who cares? You know? I am very happy in my garden. I am playing here. You have given me a wonderful play, room. I don't have time to be like God. But the woman, who is the last creation of God, gave us something special. The sense of spirituality that we as men, we do not have. We'll be like God. Well, that sounds very, very enticing. But the problem, if I eat it by myself, what is going to happen? Adam, and this little finger in a woman is very strong, no? Poor Adam comes like those little things, and say, but we cannot eat of this. No, it's nothing going to happen because you know how you convince poor Adam. You know, and Adam also ate the fruit. What happened after that? The Creator comes and say, Adam, three times, what are you? Am I here? Adam, why do you hide yourself? Because I am naked. And how do you know that you are naked? Look at that dialogue between the Creator and Adam. In which moment the Creator accused Adam? No one. Why? Because the Creator didn't come here to accuse us, give us the opportunity to make it right. And look what Adam does. The woman that you made me do it. Who was blamed for it? The Creator. Because if the Creator didn't give a woman, he would be happy. Goes to Eve. The same way. Eve, finally, Eve comes. The serpent that you made me do it. Today, 2017, we're still in the same situation. We cannot improve. We're still blaming the neighbor for everything that we do wrong. And that's what the Creator gave us with the Torah. To be responsible. Why? Because he gave us the Bechira Hofshi, free will. Giving us free will, we need to be responsible for our actions. And when we do something wrong, we need to know what are the consequences. This is what the application of the Torah is all about. It. To make it right. You see, if you do something wrong against somebody else, you need to pay the consequences of your actions. Nothing wrong with that. Oh, that's not fair. Let me ask you something. If you go someplace and you break something, do you need to pay for it or no? Depends. If somebody made me do it, you know? it's very interesting about, and by the way, your word depend is very good because we need to examine the situation. And this is what the Torah teaches. Not to apply blinded, but to look at the situation and to arrive to a decision. And this is the reason that our Creator made the Elohim. What do you say? The gods? No. The Elohim is a synonym in the scripture for saying the judges. Why they call it Elohim? Because they represent the Creator doing justice. And every judge, because what representing the Creator, needed to do the right justice. And if the judge would not do the right justice, would create a destruction in all the generation. Look at how important was for the judges to do justice. Today we ask ourselves, are our courts right or wrong? Are our courts corrupted or no? Are there countries that the courts are very corrupted or no? I am glad that I don't need to make judgment about that, because the Creator will knows that better. But many of us, we know already by empirical means that if you are a very rich person, or you have a very high position, or a nobility position, or you are in a very high position of the government, you know, sometimes the courts are very lenient, or something sometimes you can buy. But if you do not have the means, if you are very poor, or you are limited, usually you suffer the consequences of the law. And we see it all over the world. There's nothing new. We see it. Do you think that we are living in a very just world? And what happens if there is injustice? The world is self-destructive. We like and we love to blame the Creator for everything wrong that happened to us. How many times we use this statement? You know, God punished me.
When we say, why God punished me? Yeah. Why I am this one?
Why? Why you punish me? You know, and we do not look at ourselves. We don't look about our environment. Yes, there are many times that innocence pay for the sinners, most of the time. Right now, I just was looking at what is happening in the Middle East. With all the love that they have there, supposedly, you know? And you are not allowed to say that there is no love there, because you can be put in jail, you know, now. That is love? That is true love among humanity? To kill children, to rape women? To destroy people? That is love? But you cannot say anything, because that's not true. When somebody, and this is the problem that I have needed to deal as a Meyachin Yehudim, as a Messianic Jew. I follow Messiah Yeshua. And many of my friends, my Jewish friends, my own friends, they say to me, how can you believe in Jesus Christ? And I say, I don't believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in Yeshua. That Jesus Christ is an invention of the Gentiles, but that is another problem to me, I say. But the truth of the matter it is, they have given to this Jesus Christ such a bad reputation that you hear that word by us Jewish people and we start scared. Do you remember about the pogroms, the persecution, the inquisitions, and all those things? Do you remember when the Christendom pushed all the Jewish people to convert, and if they didn't convert, they were killed? Because they say it's better a Jew who repents, a dead Jew repented, than a Jew that doesn't repent and is alive. That was the motto. And you go to other religions, Islam, they don't want it or no, but they are doing the same thing. They are killing Christians, they are killing Yazidis, they are killing any Jews, anybody who they don't think like them. And even among themselves, they are killing themselves if you don't follow their group. Crazy. That's what our Creator said. Tzedek, Tzedek, Tirdof. Justice, justice, pursue justice. Now, who are the problem? Sometimes we are the problem. Why? Because for so long we have been quiet. You know, in Mishlei, in Proverbs, chapter 31, verses 8 and 9, specifically say that we have the responsibility to speak on behalf of those who cannot speak for themselves, for those who cannot defend themselves, those who they don't have the means to defend themselves. We need to speak on behalf of those. Today, we are going to give an example of the mute, the unborn child. The unborn child cannot speak for he or herself. You see, I don't care if people get upset with me and they call me that I am fanatic on that. But to me, abortion, it is murder. And there is no law, human law, that can change that. The Torah, the Tanakh, teaches very clear that we have been created to the likeness and image of God, and we are special. Now, when you commit abortion, when you allow abortion, you are allowing murder. Okay? You know, somebody yesterday told me, you know, Mother Teresa was the one that gave the solution about abortion. You know? She said, I had a solution. Give me your child and I want to put it in someplace else. If you don't want the baby, give it to me. Oh no, I cannot do that. I would feel terrible to have a child that is mine and somebody else have it. In other words, if I don't have it, nobody can have it. I need to kill it. If you try to think logically, only logically about that, who is making justice for that unborn baby? How many times, how we can make justice for those ones that they don't have the power and they don't have the ways to defend themselves and come somebody and destroy them? This is what is so important, this portion. This portion is a conglomerate of rights in different ways, put it in different ways, injunctions. You know, from the civil law to the all the types of system that are talked here. There is no an order, really, in this 53 injunctions that are given in this parasha. Even they talk a little bit about religious ideas and what you need to do in certain areas. But why? Because always is this idea. Compare with the Ten Commandments and you're going to see that means reverence to God, reverence to your to yourself in the sense that you need to keep the Shabbat and respect your parents, honor your parents, and respect to your neighbor. You follow those simple ideas, everything is going to be what I will say, hunky-dory. But that doesn't happen. Again, here is very important, you understand. When Yeshua say, I has come to bring, no, I have not come to destroy it, but to make that the Torah will be accomplished. To whom he was telling that? To the religious Jews. Why the religious Jews got upset with that? He wanted to bring the Torah. That will be the greatest thing to happen. Why? Because they have created their own Torah already. And their own Torah that gave us the way out not to keep the Torah. And the Torah made us more miserable than ever. Put more heavy things over our shoulders. That's what he said. You go to the end of the world to make a proselyte, and then when you make it the proselyte, you make it more miserable than anything else. This is the basis of any religion. Control. Mind control, spiritual control, fear control. You know, one day I was talking to somebody and I told them about what was my understanding about who Yeshua was. That person got upset and she said, "You are going to go to hell in the love of Christ." That's a religion. Because even if I was wrong in my understanding about their God, the true God is so big, so great, that what he's going to do is not to judge me for what I believe, he's going to judge me for what I do. And there is a word in Judaism that is very important for all of us. It's used in the religious setting, but I want to amplify the meaning for all of us. It's called kavana. It's the intention that you have when you do certain things. What is the intention? You have good intentions or bad intentions? Because that's what you are judged by the Creator. You see, injustice needs to start at home with yourself. If you do not do justice with yourself, how can you do justice with others? That's it or not. You know, you need to love your neighbor as you love yourself. But what is ahava? What is love in the Hebrew language? Valentine's Day? That's what is ahava? No, at all. What it really is, loyalty. Be loyal. What I mean to be loyal? You know, maybe sometimes the things are not doing great, and maybe sometimes I'm having discrepancies with certain people, you know? Sometimes I don't get along very well, but you know what? I have never had a desire to destroy the other person. I would not use my mouth to destroy the other person. I won't try to do something specific to destroy another person. I won't use hate to try to destroy others. That's kavana, intention. You're loyal to the Creator, and being loyal to the Creator, you can be loyal to the other people. This is what is teaching us today. I can give you a theological understanding about how it's been divided, these 53 misvotes that have been given. And I can tell you how compare it with the different codices that we had before giving the Torah. Do you know that many of these stipulations that we see in the Torah were nothing new in the sense that already other civilizations, they had something similar. Say, something similar. What the Torah did was cleaning up and make it just for all of us. I want to give an example. Okay? How you heard, and here is the the instructions about tooth for tooth, eye for eye, you know? Eye for eye, tooth for tooth. And everybody start understanding that, you see, here is being vindictive. The idea of being vengeance. Totally the contrary. What the Torah is teaching you? The Torah is, you hurt my eye, I'm going to pluck your eye too? Now we are even. Let me ask you this first simple thing. If I have lost my eye because of an accident with you, do you think, what are you going to make me happy that you lose your eye? Do you think that our Creator is not logical and that he doesn't have wisdom? Or somebody give me a punch in the face and my tooth falls apart. Then I say, I need to give a punch to him and make him lose his tooth. Now we both are without tooth. No, I am happy now. That's being idiotic, you know, at least. That's not what Torah teaches you. What does Torah teach you? There need to be a compensation. There need to be restitution. There need to be justice. That's what is so important. Then, by the way, was because of this, the loss of this loss, the wonderful business of insurance was invented, you know? Let me give you another one. It's not here in this 53, but it's very interesting now. I love it because when I read it for the first time, I had a big laugh. You know, in Bemidbar, there is the portion about the sona, the unfaithful woman, the sota. What I say? Sona. Sona, I'm sorry. Sota. Sota. I was going to say another word. The sota. And then, and you know what is very interesting in the sota is about if the husband feels jealous about his wife, he takes her to the priest, and he's going to make an inquiry. Then the priest is going to make a potion. You know, they're going to put certain things inside in the water, they're going to mix it, and then she will drink it. If she has been unfaithful, what is going to happen? She will blow up. You know? Okay? And nevermore, well, will die. No? But if nothing happened, not only she is faithful, but she is going to have many children, she's going to be happy everlasting. You know, at that time, you need to understand that the women, words, was a little less than an animal. Sorry to tell you, ladies. You know? And if the husband needed to choose between his cow or his wife, it was depending which cost more, you know? That was a very difficult decision. Okay? Our Creator lift up the level of the woman, make it equal to men. That's very important. Sometimes we do not understand, especially for women live. And here is interesting. You know, that was to try to pacify the jealous husband because he said, well, if God said nothing happened, it's all in my head and nothing happened, you know? That was to protect what? The woman. Because he could kill the woman anytime. And at that time, in those times, if the husband killed the wife, they give a price. They give it two more wives. No? you know, the wife you could buy and sell it like you, there was nothing else. Women, they needed to have protection. The same law in the codex, the Hammurabi Code, in the tablets, what it say? If you think your wife has been unfaithful to you, we need to do also the test of jealousy. And we, what you need to do is, we are going to make your wife cross the river that's full of crocodiles, and she swims to the other side of the river, and she doesn't drown, or she's not eaten by the crocodiles, and she survived, she's innocent. Can you, very similar laws, but you see the differences. This is what the Torah did. You know, there was different way to see and put the less capable to defend themselves, to protect. The same thing was giving with the get, with the divorce. And they're talking about when a man sell his daughter. You know, they couldn't sell the daughter. You know, the one that will buy the daughter could use it as a servant at the beginning, and then he had the right to marry her, or her son marry her. And neither of the two wanted to marry them, he needed to take it back. He couldn't resell it. And to protect her. And if he married her and then he doesn't like it, to take care of her. Remember, at that time, women are not like today, that they can have a career and they can work by themselves and they can do a lot of things themselves. At that time, if the woman was not under the covering of the husband or the family, she will not survive. This is the reason that, and there in the Torah, they teach us that we need to take care of the, in this one, we need to take care of the orphan, the widow, and the foreigner. We are seeing today what is happening around the world about the people who are running away from those places. And we have a lot of people coming, you know? And we need to be wonderful, you know? We need to receive them. We need to protect them. But what is the problem? That these people are using this way to infiltrate and to destroy us. Then we need to be wise. We Jewish people, we have suffered that for many, many centuries. Do you know that today, anti-Semitism has increased more than ever in all the times, even more than in the time of Germany? And we Jewish people, we are so divided. Instead to really to support Israel, some of us call liberal Jews. We are more anti-Semite than the anti-Semites that are not Jews. You see, Israel is not an oasis of virtue. Israel is like other nations and has good or bad things. But among all the nations, it's the most righteous nation. That little bitty Israel held more people around the world than United States, Russia, China, with all the millions and millions of dollars that they have. All the Arab country with all the millions and millions. Who is the one that's helping the world? Israel. Where the new inventions are coming. The same thing that our dear father Abraham, Abraham Avinu, was the promise that the Creator say, no? All who persecute you, they will be persecuted. All that curse you will be cursed. All that bless you will be blessed. And you shall be a blessing to all the nations. And Israel is still today is a blessing to all the nations. Then, let me finish in this way. You say I have jumped from justice to this because to me there is the greatest injustice they are committing today is what they're doing against Israel. All the United Nations, the only country that they condemn is little bitty Israel. and the worst nations, destroyers of any human rights. They don't have human rights at all. Okay? Then nobody say. There is a group called Amnesty International. You know? And the only country that they condemn is Israel. No? They don't condemn the true destroyers of human rights. You know? They don't say anything about those countries. Do you know that you in Israel you can have mosques and you can have churches. Right now in Israel and Baha'i Temple, there is freedom of religion. Go to any Islamic country, with the exception of Egypt, that they have the Coptics there and they are going really hard. Okay? But go to Saudi Arabia and trying to start only to take a Bible. There are no human rights there. Who complains about them? Nobody. Who complains about Israel? Who protects them? Everybody. Sadek, Sadek Tirdov. Justice, justice, pursue justice. Shabbat Shalom.